Right, phase one has already been accomplished here in this timber stand improvement unit. Let's talk about phase two and what that's gonna look like for the landowner. All right, guys, we're standing in northern Arkansas with Zeke Barrett of Whitetail Properties on his personal ground. And standing in a timber unit, this is a south-facing slope dominated by white oaks, chinkapin oaks, black oaks, cherry, and the assorted timber in the mid-story, right? So a very common scene for northern Arkansas, but you've done some work here. So kind of talk about talk about some of the work that you've done here just within this year.
Yeah. So some guys I know with this group called Land and Legacy, I watch their videos from time to time.
Yeah.
And so I didn't know what I was doing, but man, it was a good day in February.
Yep.
And I knew I wasn't gonna do this during the rut or whatever.
Sure.
And so I came in with a chainsaw. That's literally what I did. And I didn't know exactly what I was doing, but I knew I wanted to get sunlight to the forest floor, which you talk about a lot.
Yep.
I'd heard you talk about stump sprouts, and being in the woods my whole life, I'm like, hey, I know I need to get rid of cedars too.
So
I came in and I picked out about an acre, and I literally just cut everything that I was comfortable cutting.
Yes.
And that I knew I didn't want to take out. And then honestly, I left it until I'm walking through it here with you today, which is pretty stinking eye-opening, but it was just chainsaw. That's all it was.
Right, so now we're here in July and looking at really what the response was from that cutting. And initially what you did was reduce the mid-story of this forest in a great way, right? Choked out with eastern red cedar, but a lot of other smaller diameter trees, such as this cherry that's right here in front of us. You simply flush cut it and allow it to resprout, and we could see value coming back from the resprouts, and deer have been foraging on this, and that's a very common scene as we look out. And that's a great phase one to doing timber stand improvement with a chainsaw, felling the trees that you felt comfortable with and that you knew, right, eastern red cedar in this forest composition was not beneficial, so you take out what you can address and what you know. Now, going into phase two and what looks like for the future, you've got some options, right? You designated an acre to do this kind of as a test plot, right?
Pretty much, that's all it was.
Right, so we see value, we want to increase that. We still have not an incredible amount of sun in here. This is just roots responding to that disturbance.
Yep.
We have an overstory to then address, right? But this is where we get into larger diameter trees, 12, 14, up to 20 inch diameter trees. Not everyone feels comfortable cutting that. And the biggest thing for everyone at home is whether you feel comfortable, safe doing it, but then what happens to all that debris now that's on the ground? It would easily clog up this area and not have great mobility for wildlife. So you can do two things, depending on the scale of this test, or if we continue working westward, this is a bigger woodlot that we're in, you could consider a timber harvest, or you could have done a timber harvest first, then followed up with addressing the smaller diameter, mid-story type trees that a logger wouldn't be interested in.
So at that point, you're saying you would go in, allow the timber guy to harvest the timber,
mm-hmm.
you would come in after and do exactly what I did.
Correct.
Just after he took the big tree.
You could look at it in two ways, right?
Okay.
If you had enough timber value, you could do that initially, and then, right, you come back and address the midstory that he wasn't interested in to get the same result. Or if you don't have a big enough area or aren't ready for a timber harvest, you can come in. There's still plenty of trees in the overstory that shouldn't be here, that aren't log quality, but it's what we do with them that's going to make the biggest impact, and that's essentially going to be girdling them. Because again, we can't put too much debris on the ground in this exact area.
Okay, so expand on that for a second. When you say don't put too much debris on the ground, I'm kind of asking for
yep.
that. But
yep.
you've already mentioned it once, but explain that again, because I didn't understand what you were talking about.
Yeah.
The difference between felling these trees and leaving it there, like all of this, I didn't understand what you were getting at when you said don't leave too much structure. Why would you not want to do that?
In certain areas, that's a great question. In certain areas, you want deer to be able to transition through. You don't want every single spot on the farm to be such heavy structure and debris on the ground that deer feel comfortable bedding anywhere and everywhere.
Yep.
We can use
okay.
this structure in certain places to isolate deer to select that they will then select to bed in because of the higher structure load that's on the ground.
So with that structure comes the desire and the ability and the attractiveness to a deer to bed.
100%. Okay. So depending on that degree of what you do, right? So if this is just a general timber stand improvement unit, we're not going to put a crazy amount of debris, especially from the overstory, down on the ground, because we'd probably get resulting deer bedded in that. But if we choose to make this a bedding thicket, which we've covered in a lot of other land beat videos, you can check them out, you're going to want heavy structure.
Right,
so
right.
Just depending on the layout and the feature of this
but
specific
with what,
ground.
With what I'm wanting right here, which is I want to create food,
yep.
and I want to create cover that they're comfortable moving through, but not so much cover that this becomes a bedding area.
Right. That's where we would step in and address the overstory trees by girdling some of them, opening up
which
the canopy
be
farther.
My phase two.
Yes, which is okay. Your phase two based on your goals, objectives, and what we're going to be recommending for this unit because of its location proximity to other units on the property. We probably, though, within this larger timber block, which is 15, 20 acres or so,
yeah, that's about right. Yeah.
Have some areas that we do go way more aggressive and put structure on the ground to get them the bed in isolated pockets. To where we know we can get them to transition right to other
See,
food
it's
plots.
It's so hard for a guy like me to get my head around because
right.
I grew up hunting timber and it was, oh, don't cut the trees, that's bad. And it's, so it's, you know, as we're walking through and you're talking about some of these areas, I'm beginning to come to terms with it more. But
yeah.
It's still hard to swallow. But the stuff that you're showing me about what deer are eating,
yeah,
man, it's
and,
the light.
And that's the thing of when you're going from closed canopy forest that doesn't have a lot of timber management
yeah.
in it, you're not going to see woody browse because it's just not even available.
Yep.
But when you do begin to work, and again, this was, how long did this take you to do?
Oh, I did it in one day in February.
Yeah. So not an incredible amount of time.
3/4 of a day.
No, sure.
You know, and I took my time. I mean, it was a warmer day in February, so it was super comfortable.
Sure.
And just went through there, and I would say 5-6 hours.
Right.
Is all it took.
But it doesn't take that long to create additional value, and what would
no.
be, deer wouldn't be stopping in here to browse. We look up elsewhere, and there's not this available,
yeah,
right?
It's crazy how different this little section looks. That's why I've had the reactions, because I've not walked through here since I did it.
Exactly.
So you're seeing this for the first time, and I'm like, this is unbelievable. You're pointing out all the grapevine and
yep.
things that they're growing, and how much deer are eating off of it. Man, it... You're changing the way I think.
and that's
For
what's
sure.
that's what's fun about my job is I get to be able to go and showcase right what deer are doing, what they're foraging on, how we can then improve a property for added value from a recreational standpoint, because this is what deer eat on.
It's almost like you want the land to do the work for you.
Absolutely. I mean, it makes our job easier, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Following up phase one and phase two, yep. We'd apply prescribed fire to this south-facing slope. It's going to respond great with the prescribed fire. It's going to help reset this type of vegetation
okay.
so it doesn't advance too much. So not only are we opening up the canopy, we're adding fire and putting lots of other forage and cover on the ground. And that would also help to consume some of the structure
yep.
that you've already placed on the ground, which is great. That's just part of the TSI process.
Yeah.
But we want to manage that understory that's developing with fire, because that's the easiest tool and it's the most natural tool for this area, this region.
Yeah, that's
it would have experienced fire, so let's put it back on it.
Sure.